In this video, we'll look at how to integrate our XAF security system API into a Blazor server application that uses Entity Framework Core for data access. This is part two of a series of videos that discusses security for XAF. To watch the first video, please click on the link in the upper right corner. All right, in Visual Studio, I have my sample console application open. We'll use the code from this in our Blazor application, and I'll detail the main integration steps. First, we'll create a new project. Right-click on the CS folder and choose Add, New Project. Select the Blazor app template and click Next. I'll name the project Blazor EF Core and click Create. Let's just leave all the default settings and finish creating the project. Okay, let's set this as the startup project and run it to see what the default settings look like. Here's the app. I'll click on Fetch Data. You'll see that it loads data from our sample weather forecast. Let's delete this since we won't need it. And then go to the weather forecast service. Our console application already has a data model that we'll need. The application DB context defines the employee and department entities. We also have XAF-specific entities for permissions that come from our devexpress.expressapp.efcore.nuget package. And here we also have a Microsoft.entity framework core package installed as well that we'll need for our application. Now let's add required dependencies into our business class library. Right click and choose Add Project Reference and select our Business Objects Library. Next, we'll need to add dependencies to additional Microsoft's entity framework core packages to access SQL Server. For this, we double-click the console application project in the Solution Explorer to open the CSPROJ file. I'll copy the three dependencies and paste them into my Blazor project file. We won't explicitly add dependencies to XAF's security packages. They'll be automatically added because our Blazor application already references the Business Objects class library. We already have a data model, and we need to create initial data in the database. Our console application has an updater class that creates all required employee and department data along with the permission policy user and permission policy role objects. The next step is to query this data as a user. Let's copy this code from our console application and add it to the weather forecast service. We'll leave the names as is and edit the code. Here we need to return employee data. I forgot. We also should copy the using statements and paste these in to get rid of the warnings. Here we'd like to use our employee data. And also, we want to resolve the Configuration Manager class because it's unusable in ASP.NET Core apps. First, let's copy the connection string from our console application. As you may know, the appsettings.json file is used in ASP.NET Core applications. We'll need a special connection string section that will contain a connection string element where we'll paste our previously copied connection string. And in order to read it, we want to inject an iConfiguration interface that comes from the Microsoft.extensions.configuration package. Let's define a property, and we'll initialize it in our service constructor. This is an example of ASP.NET Core dependency injection. Now I can replace Configuration Manager with the configuration object here, and we'll call the getConnectionString method that will return the connection string element from our appsettings.json file. Okay, we are almost ready. In here, we want to return some data. I'll use the getObjects query for the employee data. And we want to return an array. All right, so let's take a quick look at the code. First, we'll initialize the security system based on the authentication standard and also our user and role types. This security system will be used to initialize secured EF core object space provider that also accepts the application DB context, as well as connection string information. This object space provider will be used to create object spaces. Technically, these are wrappers around DB context. In order to show and edit protected data, we'll need a login. For this, we'll call the logon method of the security system. And previously, we configured our authentication object to use a username, user, and an empty password. Let's save this and edit the pages we have. In the fetchData.razor page, I'll change the data model type and customize the output. We'll want to display full name information and department. I'll delete the other lines from the table header template. I'll also write code to retrieve the employee information for table cells. It's important to note that some users may not have access to certain departments depending on title, so the department property of an employee object may return null in this case. Okay, let's save this and then run it and see how it looks in the browser. I'll click on Fetch Data, and you'll see that only departments that contain development are displayed as we coded in the Updater class. It's important to note that security permissions are stored in the database, and we can edit this information and thus update our application dynamically. For example, we can modify our employee object permission in the database table. Here, we prevent the read access if the title doesn't contain the word development. I'll change this criterion to sale, return to my app, and refresh the browser. And you can see that now only departments that contain the word sale are shown. Protected data is not displayed at all. Now let's look at this in XAF. The ability to modify user permissions at runtime is one of the most popular features of our XAF security system. Since you store this information in a database, you can build custom user interfaces and delegate the function of configuration to your application administrators or users with permission. For instance, in XAF WinForms, WebForms, and Blazor UI, we've implemented this capability. Here is a desktop application that has the ability to edit type permissions. Like here, I can see the permissions for the user. There are member permissions as well as object permissions, and you can modify the criteria as you require. We also have a similar UI for Blazor. Here you can see the list of roles as well as permissions, just as it was in the WinForms app. And that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed this look at security permissions with XAF. If you like this video, give us a thumbs up. And don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell to get notified for future videos. If you have any questions, you can comment below or check the documentation. Thanks for watching, and thank you for choosing DevExpress.